Okay, do now. 1 minute and 14 seconds left. This is a continuing from yesterday and saying that, hey, I give you a bunch of series for the first five stuff, and then tell me what's the sixth term and what is the eighth term. This is on the page number four, question number four. Well, thank you for being on the correct page. Thank you for looking at question number four.
Okay,
so this is gonna be the last part of the note. So when I check your note today, this box should be having, so describing pattern, definition for N, definition for AN, definition for SN, definition for arithmetic and geometric, recursive rule, and also the very last one is going to be explicit rule. Recursive rule was from yesterday, right here. So the recursive rule. If you do have a recursive rule, go ahead and take a look at this one. Now, the differences between a recursive rule and an explicit rule is, recursive rule, you've got two equations in there. Explicit rule, you've got one equation in there. How can we actually think about which one to use? Now, recursive rule, what's recursive stands for? Do you guys remember? Backwards. And also, relationship with the previous one. So that's why we keep using the English term right here, it says previous term. Because we're going to go ahead and think about, okay, how can I take a step backward? That means that I am my current number, how can I actually find my previous term? So that's why, it's finding relationship with the previous term to your current term. That is how you use the recursive rule. But for explicit rule, explicit means that it applies on anything. Every single number, just go. Every single number that you can find, for example, 1, 3, 5, 17, 107, whatever that is, go ahead and plug in for the N, and then plug in the equation, then you will get a chance to find out, oh, what's that number? And then you know. So explicit rule doesn't have a start term, doesn't need a start term. You can have one, but you don't need one. But for the recursive rule, you must know what's the first one. Now, take a look at the triangle that you have for the bubble counting yesterday. Now, yesterday, if we cover this one, then that means that I can actually start with three bubbles. If I cover these two, then I can actually start with six bubbles. It doesn't matter where we start with, but we have to make it super clear. What's my first term, right? Remember this from yesterday? Okay, so if you have to write this in the explicit rule, we cannot actually write it because like for this triangle, for these bubble counting in this triangle shape, we have to know what's the first term. Then we have to add a number to become a second term. We have to add another number for the third term, add another number for fourth term. But without knowing what's the first term, can you keep counting, keep counting, keep counting? Can you? No, really. So based on this rule, we have to write a recursive because we have to know the first term, the starter, the initial, anything for the first. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at the one for today. Explicit. As we mentioned, explicit in our do now right here, in our do now, explicit rule means that the rule applied on everything. So let's go back and analyze our place. That means our term, counting. 5 over 1 is our n equal to 1. 10 over 3 is our second term. This is our third term, fourth term, fifth term. This is 6, 7, and 8 term. Now, by observing, 1, we have a numerator of 5. 2, we have a numerator of 10. 3, numerator 5. 4, numerator 20. 5, numerator 25. How can you actually describe the numerator in relationship with n? Yes, go ahead. How can you make a 1 turn into a 5, 2 turn into a 10, 3 turn into a 15? Yes, so how would you actually make an equation when you say describe the word multiply by 5? And your term is n. There we go. So let's start with a n equals to something, everybody. And then we know that we have a numerator, just like Evan said, it's going to be 5n. Perfect. Love that. Thank you. And then the bottom. Let's go ahead and take a look at this. I have a bottom of 1, and I start with 1. And then I have to make a 2 become a 3. Make a 3 become a 5, and make a 2, and make a 4 become a 7, make a 5 become a 9. But as we mentioned, we have to keep adding the same number at the top, keep adding the same number at the bottom. But let's go ahead and separate the top and the bottom. Let's separate the numerator and the denominator. When we only look at the denominator, when we keep adding 2, what kind of sequence is this? Arithmetic. So we just keep adding the same number, and that means arithmetic sequence is just a linear equation. Now when we keep adding the same number or keep subtracting the same number, that is just our slope, isn't it? So when we have a slope of 2, so that means I need to have at least have a 2n right there. So 1 times 2, but I still have to become a 1. 2 times 2 is a 4, but I need to become a 3. 3 times 2 become a 6, but I need to make it into a 5. 4 times 2, I need to make it into 7. How? How can I actually just make the gap cancel and into the number that I want? How can I make a 2 become a 1? How can I make a 4 become a 3? Yes, I'm going to go ahead and apply this rule to every 1 and then minus 1. Let's go ahead and double check. This is A6. That means my n is 6. next one is up. Did it check out? Okay, let's go ahead and try next one. 7. 2 times 7?
14.
14 minus 1? Did it check out? Okay, let's try the next one. 8. Plug in there. 2 times 8 is? Minus 1? Checks out? Okay, let's also go ahead and check the top. Now, this says 5 times n. So, 5 times 6 is up. 5 times 7 is up. 5 times 8 is up. This checks out to be correct on every single one. That is how we do it. This is how we set the explicit rule. Explicit rule means that I need to find a direct relationship on the n and apply on every single one to be true. So this is how we're just finding the equation for the number n, for the letter n. That was it. When you're ready, we're moving on to the next page. Oh, sorry, not the next page. The previous question, where we left off yesterday. Now, what is your math? We're going to do exactly the same thing to the question that we didn't do from yesterday, which is part D. Now, yesterday, we explained what is a recursive rule. We have to open a bracket and make it like a system of equation. But explicit rule, what do we say about it? The explicit rule has to be okay to apply on every single n. Perfect, every single n. That is good. So, I need to make a n equal to some equation. Well, let's go back and take a look at this one. Now, in here, the first term, I have 42,000 times nothing. Second term, 42,000 times 1.04 for once. Third term, times 1.04 twice. And then, fourth term, times it for three times. So, if I have an n term, so I times 1.04 for how many times? Not really. Let's compare. This actually equals to 1 times 0, 4 to 0 term. N equal to 1, I times it to the 0 power. N equal to 2, I times it to the first power. N equal to 3, I times it to the second power. N equal to 4, I times it to the third power. So I have N terms, that means times it to the how many power? N minus 1 power. Look at this one. 1 and 0, 2 and 1, 3 and 2, and 4 and 3. So that means I'm going to have $42,000 times how many? 1.04 to the what power? Parentheses n minus 1 power. That is exactly how you do it. But why was that? Let's go ahead and think about in a real life situation. The first year when you enter any company, will you have a raise?
No.
You just get your basic salary, right? You get your salary, and the next year you enter, that means, oh, you stay there for 2 years, but actually you only signed an extended contract for once. So that's why 1.04 is actually your raise for the salary for signing extra contract once. So that means you, even though you're staying there for the second year, but you're signing the other contract for only one time. So that's why you gotta go ahead and take an N minus the one. The third year you stay there, you're signing the continued contracts to only twice. So that's why you gotta have an N minus the one every single time when you're actually counting for the salary, right? So when you have the zero power, that means that, oh, the first year when you enter, you don't get a raise. So that's why this whole thing becomes a one, and you only got a $42,000. So this is applied on every single N. No matter how many years that you stay there, no matter how many contracts that you sign, you always apply to this rule. So that's why we have to call it explicit rule, because it applies on every single number, every single number for the letter N. So this is actually how your question D for the previous question. Go ahead and write it down if you haven't.
Can you send it to you?
So if you haven't written it down, please go ahead and write it down. $42,000 times 1.04 and N minus 1 power. Okay, now if you're ready, next page. Oh. 30 more seconds. This is where we left off, talking about the money. Question number 3. Okay? This is why we talked about the money yesterday, where we left off. This is the last question. And then we're just missing part D. Part D is talking about explicit rule, and now we have to learn how to write an explicit rule. Five terms. So I'm going to go ahead and tell you this is N. go ahead and make this clear for everybody first. So all you gotta do is just fill out a chart. Okay, I want A4 greater than S4. So let's go ahead and start with AN and SN. Now, A is gonna be any term that goes in that order. You whatever sequence you wanna do, you wanna keep timing something, keep adding something, whatever that is that you wanna do. And then the S is the sum. Now we talked about this before, and also just in your note, SN is the sum from the first term to the nth term. So this is something that you gotta calculate, and you only want to look at this place and this place. You want A4 greater than S4. Now, 3 minutes, turn and talk with your partner and work with your partner, write it down as your answer. Go ahead and think about, okay, how can I actually make A4 greater than S4, okay? 3 minutes, work with your partner and go. With your partner. This is not a solo work. Hear much sound. Turn and talk, ladies and gentlemen. Only 40 seconds pass. Number in my AN. That means that my trend geometric sequence like exponential function. But we actually did not talk about our positive and negative activities in there. So, normally, a linear equation when everything is positive, the trend we're following a left-hand trend or a right-hand trend? A left-hand. This is back in unit one. Let's go ahead and recall our memory. Now, an arithmetic sequence is a linear equation back in unit one. I know right now we're in unit seven. Let's go ahead and refresh our memory. Hero? Now, linear equation in unit one. We have a left-hand trend. That means that everything is going more and more and more and more, so things will become positive. But what about my right-hand trend? Things will go smaller and smaller and smaller, so the slope is negative. It's decreasing, yes. Now, back in unit three, we talk about exponential function. Normally, what is the one, what's the shape when we have exponential growth? Is the airplane taking off, right? But what about the other one? What's the reverse? Is the exponential decay? Use the correct word, decay, not decrease. Exponential decay, we're having airplane land, not crashing, it's landing. So, okay, so crashing is kind of scary, but landing is a better word, okay? Airplane landing. We're not touching the asymptote yet, but like we're actually having a landing shape. But both of them is actually saying, okay, my number is actually getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So is that actually matching what Layla is going to say? We have to add up a bunch of number that is actually getting smaller and smaller and smaller, right? That's what we want, right? So, Nami, pretend. Let's go ahead and start with the linear equation because that's actually something that's easier to do. Now, as of this moment, I want to go ahead and just set up maybe negative 1. Let's start with negative 1, it's fine. Pick me a slope that is actually helping me to go a linear equation going down. Pick me a slope. How many pick a slope? Let me see, Shakira. How many pick a slope? 2? Positive 2? Is positive 2 going to help me go down? Negative 2. Oh, thank you. So, negative 2. How can you actually have a slope? Let's go ahead and write it out. Slope equal to negative 2. Slope equal to negative 2. What is that going to do? What's the next term then based on that? If I start with negative 1, the next step that I take forward would be going down by 2. So that is? There we go. Perfect. So the next one? Everybody? Negative 5. What's the next one? Negative 7. What's the next one? Negative 9. So let's write it down. Negative 7, negative 9. Okay, now is a good time for finding the sum. Sum means what? The S means what? S means the sum from the first term to your current place, to your nth term, right? So let's start with 1. If I n equal to 1, that means that starting from here, adding everything from previous. So it's just negative 1. That was it. I start from here and add everything. There's nothing in the front. So just negative 1, adding nothing. So just negative 1. Now, n equal to 2, that means I add from first term all the way to my current location. So this is negative? Okay, perfect. I add the next one. Perfect, negative 9. What about the next one? Oh, I add up everything from previous. If I'm pointing right here, I add up this. If I'm pointing right here, I'm adding everything in here. I'm pointing right here, I add up everything in here. So what's the next one? Negative 16. What about the next one? Negative 25. By comparing, I want to compare A4 and S4, right? Let's go ahead and compare negative 7 and negative 16. Who's greater?
Negative 7
is greater. So that means my A4 is greater than S4. Is it proven to be correct?
Yes.
Yes, and this is exactly what I want. So, right now, I want to go ahead and do exactly the same thing, but just one more different slope. Pick another slope for me, everybody.
Negative 4.
Negative 1. Pick something.
Negative 3.
Okay, doesn't matter what it is. -3. Let's go and try it out. So slope equal to -3. And then right now I'm going to do exactly the same chart. N, A, N, and then S, N. Still 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is just another possibility that whatever answer that you want to pick. Again, I'm just picking another negative slope. Let's go ahead and say that I start with a 3 and a 2. Okay, so when I'm taking at 2 right now, that's my first term, and I want my slope to be -3. Let me see. Justin, can you help me out? I'm at 2 right now.
Get to know Siri.
No, bye Siri. Okay, so I start with 2, and then my next step is taking a slope of -3. What will I end up with?
4.
5? -3.
Negative 1.
Okay, so Leanne, help me the next one.
-4.
Perfect. Ibrahim, next one. Okay, Roman, next one.
this, out of this, out of this. Negative 3. So, finding S, let me zoom in. We're finding S. That means that, well, I'm pointing it here, I'm adding everything from prior. Right? Then, Kenneth, try the next one. You're adding up -7 and -3 together, you got -10. Try one more. Roman, don't say anything. So, there we go, -20. Roman, I know you want to help, but you can't still understand. Okay? Human calculator, stop for a second. Yes, go. Okay. Okay, I'm ready to get back to this. Now, we have to go ahead and compare 84 and S4 again. -7 and -10, who's greater? -7. And then, so that means A4 is greater than S4 at this term. That is exactly what we want.
Yay.
We got it. We're showing with two different terms. We're showing with two different sets, people. Okay, now on the exam, you know how to do it now.
On the exam?
On the exam. If this happened, you know how to do it? Okay, if we want the number, the sum to be smaller than the actual number, that means that we want the sum to be going smaller and smaller and smaller. So that means all we got to do is just pick up negative. Let's go ahead and try to practice writing down. see the Black Widow symbol? Same thing, just missing the middle part. Yeah. And also, Layla made one of that before for the last unit project. She made a gigantic light logo for Black Widow. It's not Black Widow. It looks like it. But it's a different color, though. So that's fine. Okay, let's get back to this. We got a Greek letter, and then the bottom, we says K equal to 1, and the top, we says 5. Now, our equation is K squared plus 2K. Now, that means I gotta start grabbing the number 1 and plug into the function and keep looping the number. So, grabbing 1, plug it in. That means what will be my first looping answer be? Let me see. Nathan, help me out. There we go. 1 squared plus 2 times 1. Or maybe it's 2. That's correct. And when I'm done looping for 1, what's my next number I'm going to loop? What's the next number? 2. There we go. So, let me see. Oh, I grabbed number 1 and plug in for K. That was it. Hold on. Then in this term, Najir, can you help me out to plug in for 2?
2 squared.
Uh-huh.
Give you A, B, and C, whatever that 26 is.
Yes, that's why. So that's why. What if you lose your 200? You don't want to solve it, right? By hand. So that's why you grab a cactus, punch it. That was it. Yeah. Okay.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about. I don't want to help you.
Geometric
Bro, stop.
No, thank you. So, it says, after how many hours will there be that much bacteria? I don't know about how many hours yet, so I'm going to leave it as a T or maybe X or any unknown that you will be for your info. Now, back in exponential growth, let me zoom in here. Please make sure that you stop the talking. So, in exponential growth, back in the days when we learned it in unit 3, we call it as a population equal to initial times your action to the certain power. So that is written as P equal to ABT. Do you remember that? Let's go replace. What's P now? What's the population?
I thought you were going to tell us that you had
storage. Population is
it's
ending
not my
population.
Phone.
What's your number? 819,200. What about your initial?
Yes, I have to trade my number.
Can you make sure that you stop the talking?
316-2076. I know they probably heard this in a video.
Okay. A is your 200. What's the B? B means your base. That means your action. What's your action? Times 2 because you double. What about the power? What's the power?
What's that?
T over 2 because it's over every single 2 hours.
You see, that says E will be.
819,200. Where?
Because that's our final output.
819,000
square
feet. That's a population. Population.
Okay. Oh shit. Hello, hello, hello.
Yes, 819,200. Right there. It's okay. It looks like a little bit sorry about that, but it's the numbers are right there, okay? Just need to pop.
Oh,
no. Now, geometric sequence. Yesterday, we say that. Oh, sorry, not yesterday. We talk about it today saying that, okay, we need to go ahead and set up an equation, which is back in last page.
This is our first class.
We spent some time talking about explicit equation. Explicit rule is An equal to what you start with, or maybe this is also can be a recursive rule, and then you keep times a 2 on every single previous term, and then N divided by 2, right, isn't it? Okay, let's go ahead and replace the number. What's your final answer? 819,200, right? What's your initial? 200. And then you times the 2 to the n divided by 2 power. As of this moment, please observe. What happened? They look exactly the same, but just the letter is different. One is n, the other one's t. But they look exactly the same thing. This further proves that our exponential growth is exactly the same, just like a geometric sequence.